Sydney's unrelenting downpour and flooding have now forced more than 50,000 people under evacuation orders, with the Premier warning this disaster is far from over. Emergency crews are still being called to rescue residents as power blackouts hit thousands of homes.
Everywhere you look, there's water. But it shouldn't be here. This is the outskirts of Richmond.
We're currently floating above the property.
Underwater, like so many, right across Sydney. And the floodwaters are still rising. Catching some residents by surprise.
Yeah, we're scary.
Betty McCall was one of them, unable to leave her Riverston home when it was inundated this morning.
But my wife's mobility impaired, so she wanted to stay, but it's kept them cribbing up, and it's about 3 inches through the floors.
When Rebecca Ginn and her two children found themselves trapped in Windsor, panic quickly set in. Help couldn't come soon enough.
My anxieties are much better now.
Relief too for relatives, just grateful to have them back on dry land.
It's terrifying.
Those used to helping in emergencies suddenly forced to do what they can to avoid needing help themselves.
A few of your neighbours have had to be rescued today. Hopefully you don't have to be.
Correct. With the rise of the water over there, it's only got you inches to go, literally.
But some people had warning. With more than 100 evacuation orders issued, not everyone chose to follow the advice.
Of the 22 flood rescues that occurred overnight, two of those flood rescues occurred in areas where evacuation orders were in place.
I'm entering the water now.
Adding to the frustration, a hoax call to the SES claiming a person was trapped on a roof in need of rescue.
That just puts our emergency services at risk of not being able to save those who really need it.
And many do.
In the process of a rescue, we've had 5 adults. These 3 children we're currently taking now and 1 dog.
Financial help is also on the way for thousands of flood-affected residents after a natural disaster was declared for 23 local government areas across metropolitan Sydney, the Hawkesbury, Central Coast and Illawarra.
This is obviously the first stage, a very important first stage, to opening up funding and further support for individuals, families and communities.
Communities angry this is happening again.
We haven't had enough rain to do this damage. It's all from the dam.
Warragamba Dam, which some residents claim is being mismanaged.
Get through the immediate crisis is what we need to do, and then we need to examine any policy response which is required.
Not a good enough response for Hugh Parry Ockerton. His family lives in North Richmond, cut off since Sunday with no power.
Flood after flood after flood, they have another inquiry, So this has gone on for years and years and years.
This is the only road in and out. Locals say last time it flooded, street signs could be seen peeking through the top of the floodwater, but this time it is at least half a metre deeper. This line of trees, the only thing lining the route. And while the relentless rain seems to be easing in Sydney, there's more misery to come.
This event is far from over. Please don't be complacent wherever you are.
Let's go live now to Amelia Brace at Windsor. Amelia, what are SES crews expecting tonight?
Well, Mark, conditions are definitely improving in Sydney, but there are still some concerns for communities in the Nepean and Hawkesbury just because those rivers are still so high. Tonight, authorities will keep a close eye again on Wiseman's Ferry, but on a whole, attention is very much moving to the north, to the Central Coast and Hunter, which are both expecting significant rainfall. In fact, 2 evacuation orders have just been issued for Bulga and Broke near Singleton, so safe to say another long and potentially dangerous night ahead, Mark.
Sounding that way, Amelia, thank you. Now to Bill Hogan at Chipping Norton. Bill, the city southwest was spared somewhat today.
Yeah, good evening, Mark. There was some improvement today. An easing in rain provided some reprieve for residents. It also allowed it for the floodwaters to recede, and soon the recovery process will begin. The floodwaters here at Chipping Norton are very slowly creeping out into the drainage system, but the clean-up here is expected to be a far longer process. And as we've learned during this weather event, things can change very quickly without warning.
When the real rain hit, the trouble began. Roads and cars first to go.
Stuck here, I can't go anywhere.
Then homes were next.
Okay, down,
leaving the SES overwhelmed with rescues and residents with yet another cleanup. Talal setting off for supplies in a canoe, his Chipping Norton home a casualty.
This time we couldn't prepare, happened so quick. Wife, she is very upset, very crying, very stressed.
Van Ho was asleep around the corner, woken by his neighbour. It was too late to leave.
So you watched it unfold from your balcony?
Yeah, we live here about 6 years and already 3 times happened.
Further south in Warranora, it was the same but different.
I've spoken to people that have been here for 45 years, yeah, never seen anything like it.
A metre higher than it's ever been, that we've seen it in 20 years, metre and a half maybe.
The Georges River rising so fast, residents, even the SES, caught off guard.
It was just too late. Like I say, on my phone, 90 minutes after the event, they're telling us to evacuate.
And so the cleanup began. A routine many now know too well.
The water was taller than me and it was probably up to here.
And while the water came and went, the cleanup took all day.
The first one tested them, the second one shattered them, but the third one has simply crushed communities along the Georges River. But for many, moving out is not an option.
What can I do? I can't move. Now everywhere, you know, the house is expensive.
An uncontrollable dilemma with no knowing what the weather will bring next. Bill Hogan, 7 News.
On the Hawkesbury, residents have scrambled to higher ground as the floodwaters cut roads. Many families were forced to secure precious belongings while some went back into the flood zone to retrieve pets.
The Hawkesbury River snaking through northwest Sydney.
This is a cow paddock. It goes down about 17 metres. It's just a big lake.
Cutting communities in half.
There's just water everywhere. Everywhere you go, you're just sloshing through water. It's through the house, through the garages, through cars, trucks, everything.
Forcing families from their home, many robbed of a lifetime of possessions and memories.
We've lost my father's photos. We've lost stamp, you know, personal, all our wedding photos, personal things.
At 8 o'clock last night, it was at the floor of the boat shed. I woke up at 4 o'clock this morning and it was hitting the floor of the caravan, so I got out of there.
Residents evacuated from McGrath's Hill overnight and Lower Portland this morning.
Probably the biggest flood that I've seen since 78.
Those who stayed were left without power, water and access to essential supplies.
The shed would be completely under and the house would probably be up to the windows now.
Today the only access to homes was on the water. Neil Perrott moved into a motel.
We're warm, what's got a telly, got the beers next to me, everything's okay.
Tammy Tribe used a kayak to save her kids' trophies and photos.
Oh, and I just grabbed their birthday presents because my twins' birthday's next week.
Who have you rescued?
Oh, just Crackers, my macaw parrot. Yeah, I didn't want to leave him there any longer. Yeah, a bit of a challenge to get him out. Had to sort of get in the aviary and catch him, you know.
In Lower Portland, the main road in and out is completely cut. Residents here have spent the night bringing their caravans to higher ground. Many locals are feeling desperate, stuck with limited options.
Well, we've got to stay. We can't afford to move. And a lot of people like that.
It's not going to be an easy night for residents along the river, but there is some good news. This water level is dropping slightly. They are reminded, though, not to rush back to their homes. They should wait for the all clear from the SES. Mark.
Yeah, stay away until it's safe. Izzy, thank you.
We currently have 102 evacuation orders in place. There were 22 evacuation orders overnight. In the Sydney metropolitan region, the Hawkesbury Nepean and around the Georges River. 55 evacuation warnings in place. There were 4 evacuation warnings overnight. Now, in terms of those orders and those warnings, that is affecting around 50,000 people across the state of New South Wales at the moment. There were 22 flood rescues overnight as well. So once again, I want to thank the SES and RFS for the work they've done in relation to those rescues. We also had the ADF on call, who were not required, but were there ready to go should the need have arisen. I want to make this point, and I made it yesterday, and I want to make it again. Of the 22 flood rescues that occurred overnight, two of those flood rescues occurred in areas where evacuation orders were in place. Please follow those instructions. If there is an evacuation warning in place, please get your belongings ready and get ready to evacuate. We have evacuation warnings to begin with so people can get prepared. And then following that, those evacuation orders are there for you to leave immediately. So if those evacuation orders are in place, please leave. Our SES volunteers and those rescues, when they get carried out, they're also putting our volunteers at risk. And ultimately, if you stay, you're putting your life at risk as well. So we've gone through a very difficult time. We've had fires and floods and numerous floods over this period of time. And those orders ensure that we get people out safely. So please, if those orders are in place and your home is affected, please leave. We currently as well have 9 evacuation centres in place across the state. 8 of those are located in Sydney. One is in the Hunter Valley. So I want to thank all our volunteers and personnel at those evacuation centres, giving care and support for those who need it right across our state. Many homes without power, 19,000 homes at the moment are without power. I want to thank our teams at Ausgrid, the teams at Ausgrid and Endeavour Energy, who are getting power on as quickly as possible for those homes that are affected. And the other point I'd make is that, over the course of this period, over the course of this week, and Jane will speak further to this, we expect more heavy rainfall to continue over the course of the week. We will see more rain moving north into Hunter today, and then that into tonight will move to the mid-north coast. So this event is far from over. Please don't be complacent wherever you are. Please be careful when you're driving on our roads. Obviously, there is still substantial risk for flash flooding across our state. And once again, as we always say, please don't drive through floodwaters. We say it every time, and some people still do it. Please do not underestimate what is beneath when you're driving through when you see those waters on the road. The simple rule to follow is don't drive through floodwaters. Go another way. That's the best way to be safe, and importantly as well, ensure that you don't have to be rescued and that your life is not at risk. And we reiterate this every time, because every time someone across our state does not follow those instructions. Those instructions are there. They're incredibly important to follow. That's the best way that we look after you, your friends, your family, and ultimately our volunteers who are on the ground day in, day out, and our personnel who are there to keep you safe. Quick update in relation to the Portland Bay bulk carrier. The situation at the moment is stable, and that carrier is anchored 1.2 nautical miles off Port Botany. I want to thank very much the crews of those tugs for the heroic work they did overnight. There were 11 metre swells. They worked through the night to ensure that bulk carrier was in a stable and anchored position. Now, it's far from over, the challenge that we're facing there, and obviously in this torrential weather and in the environment we're in, the situation can change very quickly. More support is obviously on the way, but I want to thank those men and women who were on those crews last night for the heroic work they did in incredibly treacherous conditions. To have 11 metre swells and to be undergoing and carrying out that work is incredibly impressive. So once again, thank you. And I think through all these stories, whether it's the crews on those tugs, whether it's our personnel and our volunteers, it's what makes our country great. It's that spirit of service that we're seeing day in, day out. And the best thing that we can do as a community is to continue to follow those instructions. As I said, please, if there's an evacuation order in place, leave immediately. If there's an evacuation warning, get ready to leave and follow those instructions. The SES were out last night just in the grass hill, knocking on 19,000 doors through the evening. I mean, that is the effort that our people go through to keep us safe. The best thing that we can do is follow those instructions. Now I'm going to pass to Minister Cook. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Premier. And this emergency is now well and truly into its fourth day. Whilst the rain is starting to ease across Sydney, the emergency is far from over. Today we will see, as we will shortly hear from Jane Golding of the Bureau of Meteorology, that the weather system is now moving into the lower Hunter area throughout the course of today, and we are expecting to see significant rainfall in that area, and then by tonight and into tomorrow it will move up to the mid-north coast. So we're really asking communities today to bear with us, keep working with us. It has been a difficult 4 days. There's no gilding that lily. We're not quite through it yet. We've got major flooding heights still on a number of river systems, particularly the likes of the Georges River and right, of course, down through the Hawkesbury, Nepean Valley. So we're really asking people to continue working with us through this time, and to also appreciate that, as we've said over and over again, the landscape is very saturated. Our dams are full. Our river channels are also full. Our streams and tribs continue to contribute to those river systems that are already full. And as a result, if we do get a sudden downpour in a certain location, it can cause flash flooding and river rises to occur very quickly. And that's what we saw last night in the Warrenora and Liverpool areas. There were certain areas there that were already the subject of an evacuation order. They had been since Saturday. Certain people decided to return home despite those evacuation orders being in place. And then we saw that that river rise very quickly yesterday, and it's caught some people unawares, and they've had to be rescued as a result. So our message really is, if there's an evacuation order in place, it really is there for a reason. It is to protect you and your family from needing to be rescued, and thereby preserving the very precious resources of the emergency services organisations. Our volunteers have been working around the clock now for days and days, and we need to continue working with them to make sure that we keep you safe and also that they are also kept safe at this time. I really want to thank all of the emergency services in particular that turned out to Warrenora and Liverpool last night. It was all hands on deck, and we had resources come from as far away as Leichhardt and Hornsby. It was a really big effort by police, by the Rural Fire Service, who sent a number of appliances to the area. The SES, of course, as the combat agency, had a number of units moved in there very quickly. And as a result, we were able to ensure that the community was notified very, very quickly of the changing circumstances, and we were able to evacuate people at very short notice, which was a really, really good result. A similar situation at Liverpool. We had river heights come up very quickly there, and combined with some flash flooding, caught a number of motorists unawares. It was fantastic to see our emergency services all working together to make sure that people were kept safe. I think it's worthy of note that 4 days into the event, we have not seen a loss of life through this emergency, nor have we seen any significant injuries. And that's a true testament to the skill, the dedication, the commitment, the tireless efforts of our emergency services organisations, and of course our volunteers, who do a magnificent job and have continued to do so, not just through this event, but for months and months and months now. But it's also testimony to the strong relationship that our emergency services have with our communities. And I really want to thank our communities right across the Sydney area for working with us over this time. We've heard this there are 100 evacuation orders in place and scores of evacuation warnings covering near on 50,000 people. So we just need people to continue working with us through this time. I'd like just to move briefly on to the natural disaster declarations which have occurred late last night. Working with Senator Murray Watt, we have announced 23 local government areas as areas covered by this event. as natural disaster declarations because they have been so deeply impacted by this weather event so far. So those local government areas, just to let everybody know, we've got Blacktown, Blue Mountains, Camden, Canterbury Bankstown, Campbelltown, the Central Coast, Cessnock, Fairfield, Georges River, the Hawkesbury, Hornsby, Kiama, Lithgow, Liverpool, Northern Beaches, Penrith, Shell Harbour, Shoal Haven, Sutherland, the Hills, Whinger-Carrabee, Wollondilly and Wollongong. So there's quite an extensive list there covering everywhere from Sydney Metropolitan, the Central Coast, down through that Illawarra area. And this is obviously the first stage, a very important first stage, to opening up funding and further support for individuals, families and communities as we move from the emergency response phase, which we are still very much in at the moment, but into the early stages of recovery and then into the medium and longer term recovery processes which will be required as a result of this flooding event. So for people who would like to understand a little bit more about what that means for them, I'd encourage people to reach out to Service New South Wales on 1377 88 and we will be there to provide some assistance to you. I think just finally, before I hand over to Jane Golding, I'd really like to return to an earlier point that I made, and that is around thanking our volunteers across all of our emergency services organisations. I've been saying this consistently since having the great honour and privilege of being the Minister for Emergency Services. I'm so deeply proud of all of your efforts. This is, again, the fourth day of a very long weather event, and you've had to step up hour after hour through the night, through the day, to make sure that people are safe during this time. And so whether you're part of our Orange Army, the wonderful SES, or the Rural Fire Service, Surf Life Saving, Marine Rescue, the Volunteer Rescue Association, and finally, very, very well supported by our personnel at Fire and Rescue New South Wales, and police and ambulance. Thank you so much to all of the volunteers who are doing so many hours at this time. Thank you to your families, because every time you leave home, you are taken away from your families, and they're very understanding and supportive of everything that you do, and I'm very grateful to them. And finally, thank you to all of the employers who have allowed employees to leave their workplace time after time after time over the past couple of years, particularly in relation to this latest flooding event. I'll now hand over to Jane Golding for her weather update. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So the focus of the rainfall yesterday was very much over the Illawarra, the Sydney and the southern parts of the Hunter District. Through the course of the day, contracted out of the Illawarra, and then through the course of the evening, it contracted out of Sydney into the Hunter District. And what that meant is quite a few locations yesterday saw a good 150, 200 millimetres on top of hundreds of millimetres that they'd received over previous days. There was a stretch of Sydney around the Warrenora and the Georges that received, you know, around about 100, 150 mils through the course of yesterday, and that resulted in the Georges River and the Warrenora responding to that rain, and we did see some flood warnings issued overnight. That water is... That rain also moved into the Hawkesbury Nepean, and that rivers continued to respond. I'll go through the flood warnings in a little bit. But what that means that some locations across New South Wales have seen, you know, 800 millimetres over the last 4 days, and many over 500. So the landscape's pretty saturated at the moment, and it's going to take quite a bit of time to dry out. The focus overnight, the focus was very much the Central Coast, and now that rain band is over the Lake Macquarie through to Cessnock and up to Newcastle area, and we could expect to see similar totals up in that neck of the woods that we saw yesterday, so over 100 millimetres for some locations to be expected today in the northern parts of the Hunter District, so Lake Macquarie, Cessnock, up to Newcastle. And then tomorrow, and this is a bit of a change to the forecast policy, we're seeing signs that there'll be a low develop off the coast and the trough stall for a little bit, which means we're now forecasting for some heavy rain to occur in the mid-north coast tomorrow, probably up to about Coffs Harbour is the area of risk. Our flood team at the moment, they're having a look at what that might mean to the rivers up there, and there'll be a flood watch issued over the next few hours. But we can expect to see some of the rivers in the mid-north coast respond to the rain that falls there tonight and tomorrow. We also saw quite a windy night for Sydney and the Hunter District, with winds nudging gale force along the coast, but strong and gusty through into the western parts of those districts as well, and that means likely see quite a bit of damage from trees down, power lines down as well today, until that wind really starts to ease off. The seas with the winds, they're still up, so pretty treacherous conditions still exist out on the Sydney coast, the Hunter coast, and that'll probably only slowly drop off during today and won't really see an easing through until tomorrow. So we do have several flood warnings still current, and a few warnings for major of note. So the Georges is back down to moderate at the moment, which is great. Most locations on the Hawkesbury Nepean, we're still seeing major flood levels. The Menangle area, which saw that major flooding over the weekend, that looks like that's now dropping down into the moderate range. But downstream of the dam, we're still seeing major flood levels, and for some locations, they'll keep gradually rising during the course of today. That water's going to take a bit of time to subside, and it's moving pretty quickly, so quite dangerous out on that river at the moment and for the next couple of days. We also have major flood warnings out for the Wollumbi Brook at Bolga. It's a site of particular note. Tugra Lakes, we're also expecting the rivers to rise in that area through the course of today, and Long Jetty reached the major threshold tonight. So that rain that fell last night through the central coast, and yesterday they saw around about 180 mils. That's making its way down through those river systems. And the other key river of note with major flood warnings at the moment is the Macquarie Bell. So that's west of the ranges. We've had a major warning out there for a couple of days. But Warren, the town Warren, is looking like they'll see major flood levels. I believe it's tomorrow. So in summary, that persistent rain, it's still hanging around. It's in the Hunter today, likely to move into the mid-north coast tomorrow. The floods, even if the rain has eased, will wet those areas where the rain has eased, and we're just seeing showers at the moment. It'll take a bit of time for the water to make its way out to sea, so major flood warnings current, likely to continue for the next couple of days. And I'll hand over to Commissioner York to take you through some intel from the SES. Thank you.
Thank you. So today we've heard very strong messages from the Premier and the Minister in relation to following the orders and the advice of the New South Wales SES that goes out to the community. I also want to thank the community for those who have followed that advice and made preparations and evacuated where we have put in place evacuation orders, which there are a large number of them now in force. A couple of things happened overnight, which I think we need to reflect on the need to follow that advice and those orders and warnings that the SES put out. So Warrenora, the waters rose very rapidly last night. One of the issues for us is to get in and see and make sure that the community has evacuated. So that area had been under an evacuation order for some time, but it was clear that some people had not evacuated. Now, these levels that we saw overnight were equal to around the 1988 flood levels in that area on the Warrenora. And I know that some people might have moved into the area. Some people think that they're experienced in floods. But I think this shows the importance, when we give an evacuation order, the importance of actually leaving the area. So we did have to place our volunteers and other rescue services at risk to go into that community and make at least two flood rescues to get people out. The reason why we do an order is to get you out so that it's safe, because we cannot always promise that we will get back there. And as shown, our resources were quite stretched. So the waters were flooding around the Liverpool area, which had a significant impact on the roads and the traffic. And again, we saw people driving into floodwaters, being stuck in floodwaters, and calling SES and other emergency services to come out and save you from and place you in and put you in a place of safety. So it really stretches our resources. We had over 1,000 volunteers out yesterday, and that will happen again today. We had 47 flood rescue teams out, and we had to call more up from the Illawarra area to respond to those calls for assistance. So again, if you don't have to travel on the roads, please don't do anything but essential travel. It is dangerous. The waters rise very rapidly, as we saw last night, and can put you in place in danger and require the emergency services agencies to come out and save you. Also, very disappointingly, we had a hoax last night of a person on a roof who was in need of a flood rescue, and it turned out to be a hoax. But what happens is, because it's to try and save a life, we target our resources and try and get out there to save that person, and it means we take them away from other areas. And we really had a lot of calls for assistance last night that were really important. So I call for the community. It was only one matter. Most of the community has been really good, but it just puts our emergency services at risk of not being able to save those who really need it. So it's really important to follow those orders. So our footprint of operations is obviously enlarging based on the forecast of the Bureau. Moving into that Hunter area, we have put additional resources up there. We've also called on additional resources from Victoria, and we're talking to the other states today about what might be needed just over the next couple of days if we need assistance and who's available. And we'll be looking at what the weather brings going up into Newcastle and the mid-north coast. So really very operational again today. Sydney's not out of out of danger. This is not a time to be complacent. This is a time to continue what we say is have access to information, know what your risk is, follow the orders or warnings from the New South Wales SES, and take action when it's needed. Again, sometimes the egress routes get cut off and you can't get out, and we try and make sure that we let you know as soon as possible. And obviously, last night at McGrath Hill, during the night, we did have to evacuate a large part of that area because it did become isolated as the waters rose. So really important, it's risky out there. Understand your risk. Have those emergency kits ready to go with your important documents, insurance documents, medications, anything you might need in case we do issue an evacuation order for those areas at risk. The weather will continue for a number of days, so it's still dangerous as the water goes away. There's possibly a lot of damage to the roads. It will be a while before, for example, the bridges come back out on the Hawkesbury River, and it will take a while, as the Bureau have said, for the water to be able to get away. And the obviously land's very saturated. So it's still dangerous out there. Please take notice of our warnings and stay safe. Thank you.
Commissioner, just to clarify, you had volunteers advise of risking Warrenora last night because people had not evacuated on Saturday.
That's right. So the evacuation orders had been issued many hours before, and we got calls for assistance for evacuations last night. So we put the ADF helicopters on standby in case we needed them, but we're able to, with the help of RFS and Fire and Rescue, I think we're down there as well, get those people out from that area. So
it's enormously frustrating hearing your call.
It is frustrating. As I say, we try and get those warnings out so people can get ready, but an evacuation order is very serious in that we are now at the stage where we are saying that area will be prone to flooding and lives could be placed at risk.
Just to clarify the situation in the Hawkesbury and Nepean, obviously that weather system's moved north. Is it now just a matter they're waiting for the waters to recede, or is there still sort of an active threat in that area?
I might hand to Jane in a moment, but from our information, there is still a chance of rains today. and it will take a while, and there's still water flowing down into the catchment areas, so it takes a while for those rivers to, just because it's not raining at that moment in that location, there's many areas where the water flows down into the catchment, into the river system, and keeps the rivers at a high level for some period of time, even though it does stop raining. Did you want to add anything to that? Mm-hmm. Okay, other questions?
Premier, just in terms of the Central Coast and Hunter, what's been done there? Obviously, it's moving up there. Are you now moving all the resources up to the
operational?
Yeah, up to the.
We have opened up our operations centre some days ago on a 24/7 basis, and we are escalating the number of resources that we have in that area, so we can respond to the requests for assistance from those communities that may be affected. As I said, we did move resources from Illawarra into the metro. So as the weather front moves further north, it then releases resources from other areas that we can send into those areas. So we'll be watching it very closely as to what happens with those rivers today, and working with the Bureau in relation to their forecasts.
And have the extra ADF personnel, you asked for another 100, I understand, so they're now 200 on the ground, and where are they?
They're not on the ground yet. We still have 100 on the ground. We expect to get more ADF personnel tomorrow, and we are planning now with the ADF as to whether or not we move them up into the Hunter, Newcastle, Central Coast area, so that they can respond, particularly with sandbagging, door knocking, and additional assistance for the New South Wales SES.
Premier, just in terms of the response together with the federal government, we know that Anthony Albanese is planning to head out to the flood areas as soon as he gets back in Australia. How different has this time been in terms of the working together and the speed at which perhaps you've responded, do you think?
Well, I think we've learnt a lot. I mean, obviously we have the review being conducted at the moment by Mary O'Kane and the former Police Commissioner Mick Fuller, but I think there's no doubt in my mind, in terms of this time around, that in terms of immediate response and the coordination with the Commonwealth Government has been very strong. The fact that we've had ADF on the ground immediately, talking to the Commissioner earlier this morning, so the SES Commissioner earlier this morning, the ADF were on standby last night to conduct rescues. Now, those rescues were not required in the end, but to have that presence on the ground, to be helping in assistance with the coordination, whether that's sandbagging, whether that's door knocking and providing that extra assistance. We're talking thousands of homes when you're going door to door to give people and provide those instructions and understand what support is needed. That's a massive operation. So to have that coordination, so I'd say, you know, obviously, you know, the Prime Minister overseas, I've been in contact with him numerous times over the course of yesterday, and the Acting Prime Minister, Richard Miles, last night, who I understand is in the Hawkesbury Nepean area today with the Federal Emergency Services Minister. And my office is obviously organising with the Prime Minister's office to be out on the ground as soon as he returns.
And is any of this weather event and this response going to form any part of the flood inquiry that is underway by O'Kane and Fuller?
Look, I don't think so. I mean, I think that there are immediate things that you don't need to review. I think the fact that when these events occur, it's always better to err on the side of caution and to have that coordination. Now, we've stood up CEOC straight away, and that coordinates, which we did last time, all the New South Wales government agencies, allows the Commissioner here, the Deputy Police Commissioner, to coordinate all of the government agencies from a state level across the board. But it's important to have that federal government support as well. And the fact that we put in a DAC request for 100, those troops were on the ground immediately. I know they've been based largely in the Hawkesbury Nepean area and have been working tirelessly there, but to have another 100 on the ground, as the Commissioner, the SES has said, by tomorrow, also provides that support. As Jane has pointed out, we don't know yet that there won't be further challenges over the course of this week. We expect the rainfall to continue. We expect that rainfall to move further north and more support to be provided. To Ash's question in relation to the allocation of resources, we move those resources, the SES operationally moves those resources to where it's needed, but ultimately in some areas that support is still required.
Thank you.
As with the disaster declarations that have been made, what in practical terms can people look to? What kind of help might there be? And what is the onus on them to provide paperwork and so on?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I mean, one area I think we've certainly learnt is to make sure that we don't have bureaucracy get in the way of providing that financial support. Now, it has to be done in a way that mitigates against fraud. I know that from a Service New South Wales perspective, that financial assistance is from the Northern Rivers and other declared areas, local council areas across the state, on those floods we've had in the past, has resulted in money getting out the door faster than in the past, and that's important. I still believe we can do better, and I'd expect that to occur in result of these floods. At the moment, though, we have many people still in one of those 9 evacuation centres, getting that care and support. Now, having those declarations provides a focus of government agencies, both at a Commonwealth and a state level, that these are the areas that we need to continue to provide operational support, and ultimately that then rolls into financial support and assistance for those who need it. And my expectation is that that money gets out to those who need it as quickly as possible. Now, that sometimes, from my experience, comes with a challenge when you've got a joint Commonwealth-state arrangement, because the guidelines that are in place are obviously set together, and we from a state level provide that operational financial assistance out the door. Now, where we had problems last time was trying to provide greater flexibility with the Commonwealth government in relation to those guidelines to get the money to those who need it as quickly as possible. My expectation this time is that if changes are needed to provide that financial support, then those changes will be made as quickly as possible.
Just back on the PM, has the criticism of Mr Albanese been fair? There's been some criticism that he took too long to get in contact with you.
I don't think so at all. He was in the Ukraine. In fact, he called me yesterday. I'm not going to where he was from an operational perspective, but he called me yesterday and as soon as he could. He's overseas on work that's important for Australia, and in fact the communication I've had with both him and the acting Prime Minister last night has been that firstly he's doing everything he can to get back as quickly as possible. The acting Prime Minister is up in the Hawkesbury Nepean with the Emergency Services Minister. I know that our Emergency Services Minister has been in close contact with theirs. In fact, he was present yesterday at SEOC. I mean, that's the first time we've had I might be incorrect here, Steph, you can correct me if I'm wrong. The first time that we've had an Emergency Services Minister at a Commonwealth Government here. So I think that's important because we're running the operational side, but them having an understanding of what's going on the ground is incredibly important. So obviously there are challenges across our state. There are domestic challenges that are international challenges that the Prime Minister has to balance up. But from my perspective as Premier, the engagement has been incredibly positive, supportive and open to providing anything that they can do to assist us.
On another matter, we're expecting an interest rates announcement. We obviously can't anticipate what that might be, but the economists tell us it will be another upward move. At what point, given this is the state of the highest level of mortgage indebtedness, do you start to worry about where those rates are going?
I think, Hugh, there's always a challenge for people across our state in relation to the economy. And I believe there's no doubt we're going into a higher inflationary environment. We expect to see interest rates rise, and that puts pressure on household budgets. I would expect that to continue over the next 9 months. That's the expectation from Commonwealth and state treasuries, and that provides difficulties. I mean, I don't want to preempt what the rate rise would be today, but on an average 800,000 loan here in New South Wales, if you're talking about a 0.5% rate increase, that's a couple of $100 every single month out of household budgets right across New South Wales. That's incredibly challenging for everyone. Now, from our perspective, we're doing everything we can with a range of cost of living programs to help, but it's going to be a very difficult time nationally for households as we move into a more difficult environment. And that comes off the back as well of what's been a very challenging 2 years, where governments, both at state and federal levels, have invested record amounts to get businesses through, to get workers through, to get families through. And now as we enter into this period, that's going to create another challenge. And we'll continue from a government perspective to do whatever we can to ease the cost of living burdens on families right across New South Wales. That's what good governments do. But the reality is we've been in a low interest rate environment for a significant period of time. It's clear that those interest rates are rising. We're entering a higher inflationary environment. And that puts challenges on families right across the state. We'll continue to stand with them through that. And once again, I say this is on the back of a very difficult, it's been a challenging time for everybody across our state over the last years, whether that's been bushfires, floods again, the pandemic. But our people have stood strong, and together we will get through the economic challenges that come our way.
Premier, Nine News has revealed there are almost 400 defects in the Lane Cove tunnel. There's concrete that's fallen in, there's cracks in other parts. What assurances can you give drivers?
Well, my expectation, obviously, with the operator is that they'll work very closely to remedy those defects. And obviously, I know that those matters they're currently working through with the contractors to get those defects rectified as quickly as possible. And that's my expectation. But ultimately, it's done as quickly as possible, in a way that provides as little inconvenience to motorists across Sydney.
But the issue's actually been bubbling away in the courts for 5 years.
Well, they should get it resolved.
The government didn't realise.
Yeah, well, I realised today when that information came to light, and my expectation is that those defects are rectified as quickly as possible with as little inconvenience to motorists across our state.
Premier, no result out of Fair Work last night.
No.
That the longer this thing goes on, we're told that it's going to cost hundreds more millions of dollars, and 6 months delayed in the metro. How are you going to manage all that? I mean, are you willing to give it all, to sign a legal deed, to do something?
Well, we've been giving a lot for a long period of time, and we wouldn't have taken the action to go to the Fair Work Commission if I didn't believe that was the appropriate action in the best interest of the people of our state. I will always put our people first. We have worked tirelessly in relation to reaching an agreement. We made that change, which I announced last week, in respect of modifications to the intercity fleet. Now, I made that concession in circumstances where I did not believe, and do not believe today, that those modifications need to be made. You have a rail regulator, a national rail regulator, a safety regulator, that has said that the trains are safe to be on the tracks and operate. Now, when I went through all of this and obviously engaged with both relevant ministers in respect of this issue, it became very clear to me that the cost ultimately to the taxpayer was going to be so substantive anyway because of the escalating costs of those trains sitting and not operating. So my decision was that we would go to the Fair Work Commission to get this matter resolved. And it was, to be frank, incredibly frustrating last week in circumstances where the discussions have all sense of, we had a log of claims working through that we've worked through over a substantial period of time, to get to a point where the most outstanding issue, really the only outstanding issue, was the intercity fleet and the modifications to be made. And I made those modifications at expense of the taxpayers of New South Wales, because it was the right thing to do, to get the trains on the tracks in the circumstance we found ourselves in. For then the union to say, well, we're just going to continue with industrial action, particularly at a time where we've seen flooding and torrential weather across our state. We've had businesses, and this is lost in all of it, there are businesses that rely on the public transport network to survive. We've had so many businesses close during the pandemic for months on end, trying to make ends meet to get through. And the approach that the union movement has taken in not acting in good faith, in a fair and reasonable way with the government, where we have done everything we can, it gets to a point where, from my perspective, from the union bosses, this is all about politics. It's not about our people. And my job as Premier is to look after every single person in this state. This matter needs to be resolved. I have said numerous times at press conferences that I want those trains on the tracks as quickly as possible, and I'll do everything I can to achieve that end. The decision to go to the Fair Work Commission was not made lightly, but it was made because, in my view, it is the only way to have this matter resolved and ultimately to have the industrial action cease. And I want a resolution. I want my call to the RTBU and other union bosses is two things. Focus on our people. I understand you have your members, and that's important, but focus on the people of our state as well. And I also say that to other unions across New South Wales who are striking in circumstances where here in our state we have the highest pay increases of any state, any jurisdiction in the country. We've done it in a fair and reasonable way. We know there are pressures. You know, Hugh asked about the interest rates. Every family budget in an inflationary environment as well is under significant pressure. There are 8 million people across our state who are doing it tough right now, and I want every single one of them to get through. But that means we're all in it together, as we've been saying for 2 years in the pandemic. And the public sector is about 10%, and 90% of our population is not in the public sector. So it's all about finding a fair and balanced approach. I believe we have done that, and I just want to have this matter resolved.
So where do we stand now? Because the industrial action is tomorrow. We haven't heard anything.
It's in the commission. It's in the commission today.
You were going to meet with Alex, though. Do you do that this afternoon?
Well, I'm taking legal advice in relation to that. I mean, that was my intent.
At the moment, the Fair Work Commission is doing its thing, but yeah. We're now 6 hours through a work.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that. And obviously, what is in place in terms of industrial action is in place. Now, if anything we can do to cease that industrial action, we will. And that's what we're seeking.
Last question.
But the point is, that's what's in place at the moment. So I understand that, and I understand the frustration of every commuter across our state. And also, yes, we're on school holidays, but there are many people who want to get out and about. We're sitting here today talking about the challenges of driving through floodwaters, the challenges and risks that are on the road. We're asking motorists to take precautions, to follow the rules that are in place. Public transport plays a crucial role every day, but on weeks like this, even more.
And Premier, just quickly, your family has been linked to some serious allegations about branch stacking in the Hills District. Are you concerned about the sort of allegations of the behaviour of your right faction and even your family in this?
No. I mean, obviously, it's disappointing to see all political parties, all organisations have their challenges, and I don't think those things should be aired publicly, but when they are, that's disappointing. In relation to some of the allegations that have been made and that were made in the Parliament 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, I sought advice in relation to that and referred those matters as appropriate to the ICAC, and that is their role to investigate. And ultimately, though, these matters are matters for the Liberal Party. I think it's incredibly unhelpful to see those matters aired publicly. But my views in relation to the federal election and the pre-selection process of the New South Wales division, I thought was disappointing. I think I called it a debacle, and that's what it was. Ultimately, political parties play a very important role in our democracy, and the integrity of those political parties needs to be beyond reproach. They play an important role because they play a role in selecting members of parliament to represent local communities. And expectation is that the Liberal Party has the highest and best practices possible. But ultimately, if the parties are there to select members, what's that all about? That's all about electing people to parliament to represent people and focus on people every single day. And that's what we do here in the New South Wales government. And that's what both sides of politics, in my view, in the main work towards. And we shouldn't have, it's disappointing when organisations, Labor Party, Liberal Party, all those matters that are internal end up spilling out of the public debate. And ultimately, there matters two things. They're inside the beltway, they're inside the beltway issues for political insiders, point one. And point two, what it demonstrates is they're not focused on what's most important here, and that's our people.
So you're not concerned about your family's alleged involvement in the ranch
stacking? No. And if that, and obviously I saw those allegations last night, but no, and I have no knowledge of those matters. Importantly, in relation to that, if that is in relation to those matters that were spoken about in the New South Wales Parliament, those matters were referred to the ICAC. Thanks.